Psalmul 145, Psalm 145. Te voi înălța, Dumnezeule, împăratul meu, și voi binecuvânta numele Tău în veci de veci.
Amin.
În fiecare zi te voi binecuvânta și voi lăuda numele Tău în veci de veci. Mare este Domnul și foarte vrednic de laudă și mărimea Lui este nepătrunsă. Fiecare neam de om să laude lucrările Tale și să vestească isprăvile Tale cele mari. Voi spune strălucirea slăvită a măreției Tale și voi cânta minunile Tale. Oamenii vor vorbi de puterea Ta cea înfricoșătoare și eu voi povesti mărimea Ta. Să se trâmbițeze aducerea minte de nemărginita Ta bunătate și să se laude dreptatea Ta. Domnul este milostiv și plin de îndurare, îndelung răbdător și plin de bunătate. Domnul este bun față de toți. Și îndurările Lui se întind peste toate lucrările Lui. Toate lucrările Tale te vor lăuda, Doamne, și credincioșii Tăi te vor binecuvânta. Vor spune slava împărăției Tale și vor vesti puterea Ta ca să facă cunoscut fiilor oamenilor puterea Ta și strălucirea plină de slavă a împărăției Tale. Împărăția Ta este o împărăție veșnică și stăpânirea Ta rămâne în picioare în toate veacurile. Domnul sprijinește pe toți cei ce cad și îndreaptă pe cei încovoiați. Ochii tuturor nădăjdesc în Tine și Tu le dai hrana la vreme. Îți deschizi mâna și saturi după dorință tot ce are viață. Domnul este drept în toate căile Lui și milostiv în toate faptele Lui. Domnul este lângă toți cei ce Îl cheamă, lângă cei ce Îl cheamă cu toată inima. El împlinește dorințele celor ce se tem de El, le aude strigătul și îi scapă. Domnul păzește pe toți cei ce-L iubesc și nimicește pe toți cei răi. Gura mea să vestească lauda Domnului și orice făptură să binecuvinteze numele Lui, să binecuvinteze numele Lui Cel Sfânt în veci de veci. Amin.
Amin.
You are so awesome.
Amin.
So highly seated above us, so beautiful and perfect, so holy, and we are so little, and so unfinished, and so unworthy, and yet you find pleasure in allowing us to worship you today. We praise you for this, because it is through a very holy and expensive sacrifice that we are allowed to come in your presence and worship you today. And I pray that you will grant us this privilege of not being unmoved, of not being indifferent, of being instead filled with the Holy Spirit, so that our worship and our shouts of joy and our singing will be inspired by your Holy Spirit and therefore pleasant to you today. I pray that you will search every heart and every soul that stepped into this place. And don't let us go from here unchanged. Don't let us go from here old. Don't let us go from here unfinished, but rather touch us, dear God. Dear Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we cry to you because we need you. We need you for this school year. We need you for our families. We need you for our kids. We need you for this society. We need you for this country. We pray that you'll be here with us tonight and you'll allow your Holy Spirit to work on us. Pray this in Jesus Christ's name and for His glory. Amen.
Domnul să rămâne încânteze, frate și surori, și proaspeții în casei Domnului, în locul acesta. În seara aceasta avem un serviciu special. Toate serviciile noastre sunt speciale pentru că sunt momente în care ne închinăm Domnului și ne apropiem de Domnul prin Harul Lui, prin Harul Domnului Iisus. Acesta este special, în mod special, pentru că marchează începutul anului școlar pentru școlile Logos, Logos Christian Academy și Logos School of Music. Domnul să binecuvinteze și aceste instituții de învățământ creștin. În fiecare an, sărbătorim la începutul anului nu școala, nici învățământul, nici cultura, ci întotdeauna ne închinăm Domnului. Și mai degrabă decât o laudă adusă celor care sunt implicați în lucrările acestea, momentele acestea sunt momente în care ne recunoaștem, așa cum în rugăciunea lui spunea și fratele Laurențiu, care ne recunoaștem dependența noastră de Domnul. În toate lucrurile pe care le facem, niciun lucru bun nu-l putem face despărțiți de Domnul. De aceea, Domnul, aducem în seara aceasta lauda noastră și rugămintea noastră ca să binecuvânteze școlile Logos și în anul nou școlar. Welcome to this special service that we're having tonight. Brothers and sisters and friends, we're very happy to have you here and worship with us. This is a special service because it marks the beginning of the school year. The school year already started, but now we want to have a special service for the local schools, Logos Christian Academy and Logos School of Music, in which we worship the Lord who gives us this grace to be able to have schools associated with our church. We hope that we all will be able to experience God's grace and approach Him and bring Him our worship, our praises. Programul a început despre școlile Logos. Școala de muzică Logos are o colaborare, noi ca biserică, de fapt, noi ca biserică avem o colaborare bună cu, printre alții, Institutul Biblic Emanuel din Oradea. Școala de muzică Logos are o colaborare de felul acesta și de câțiva ani s-a deschis o filială sau o școală asociată în cadrul Institutului Școala de muzică Logos, afiliată și the counterpart of our Logos School of Music. De data aceasta am vrea să facem ceva și pentru ei, să le facem parte din bucuria noastră. Și că vom avea o strângere de daruri pe care le dăm Domnului, cu scopul special ca să ajutăm școala de muzică Logos din Oradea. As I already started saying, we have a good collaboration with Emmanuel Bible Institute in Oradea and the church that's associated with it, and they also started with Frater Estelle's help Logos School of Music there, and we would like to continue this cooperation, this collaboration by extending some help to them. We will have a gathering of gifts that we will present to the Lord with this special aim, this special purpose of helping Logos School of Music in Oradea. Let us all praise the Lord with a song, and during this time we will present our gifts.
Pace. Sunt Ana Semășan. Dumnezeu m-a binecuvântat să fiu al doilea an la Logos, învățătoare la clasa a doua. Am să vă spun din experiența personală trei lucruri importante care le facem la Logos. Și ca să puteți să le memorați, am să vi le prezint în ABC order. În primul rând, la orice școală, învățăm academics. Îi învăț pe copii, îi învăț să știe mai bine să scrie și să citească. În al doilea rând, îi învățăm Biblia. În clasa a doua, anul trecut, am avut The Bible Bee, o acțiune la care toți au primit premiul întâi. Copiii au învățat aproape 100 de versete și le-au recitat înainte la high school. ABC. Caracterul creștin. Noi, învățătorii, profesorii, ne dăm silința ca să trăim cum ne învață Biblia și același lucru îi învățăm și pe copilași. Să aibă un caracter creștin. Am să vă citesc două versete din Psalmul 78. Ce am auzit, ce știm, ce ne-au povestit părinții noștri, nu vom ascunde de copiilor, ci vom vesti neamului de oameni care va veni laudele Domnului, puterea Lui și minunile pe care le-a făcut. Amin.
Amin. Să cerem binecuvântarea Domnului peste lucrarea școlii Logos. Dumnezeule mare și minunat, suntem privilegiați să te cunoaștem, pentru că Tu ni te-ai descoperit. Suntem privilegiați și binecuvântați să-L avem pe Fiul Tău, pe Domnul Iisus Hristos, pentru că Tu ni l-ai dăruit. Suntem privilegiați și mulțumiți că avem parte de providența Ta, pentru că însuți Tu ne-ai promis că te îngrijești de noi. Acum, la început de an școlar, te rugăm să manifesti această grijă părintească pentru toată lucrarea la care ne-ai chemat. Păzați pe meritele Domnului nostru Iisus Hristos, te rugăm și îți cerem, îndrăznim să Cerem îndurarea ta peste noul an școlar. Cerem ca bunătatea ta să dea elevilor o creștere sănătoasă, să crească nu doar în dobândirea cunoștințelor, ci în cunoașterea ta și a Domnului Iisus Hristos. Știm că viața veșnică aceasta să te cunoască pe tine. Dă-le din belșug această cunoaștere și dă-le bucurie a vieții veșnice. Învață-i să gândească corect și să fie drept și să aibă caracter în trăire. Capacitează, Doamne, să accepte disciplina viitoare care le se dă în această școală. Și păi să fie discipul ai Domnului Iisus Hristos. Ajută-i să asimileze cuvântul Tău care instruiește, cuvântul Tău care înviorează sufletul, cuvântul Tău care luminează ochii, cuvântul Tău care aduce desăvârșire și produce fericire în viață. Prednicește să aibă în ei chipul Domnului Iisus Hristos. Ne rugăm pentru părinții copiilor, rugăm să-i prețuiască așa cum îi prețuiești Tu și să-i consideră o moștenire pe care au primit-o din partea Ta și să-i crească în frica și cunoașterea Ta. Ajută-i să prețuiască și pe profesorii care se ostenesc cu copiilor. Ajută-i să procedeze așa cum ne învață cuvântul Tău, să facă parte din binecuvântările lor materiale și celor care învață pe copiilor. Păi să te cinstească și în acest fel, să înțeleagă că ceea ce seamănă acum, dacă o fac cu generozitatea care vine de la Duhul Tău ce Sfânt, acest lucru le va aduce bucuria recolte mai târziu. Ne rugăm pentru profesori să-i umpli de entuziasm în această lucrare la care e chemat și să îi învrednicești să modeleze pe copiii care au în subagheta lor în asemănarea Domnului Iisus. Învrednicește să facă această lucrare cu dedicare și cu abilitatea care vine de la Duhul Tău ce Sfânt și cu nădejde că vor prin răsplata și cu una din mâna Ta în ziua răsplătirii. Te rugăm să binecuvântezi pe părinți, să poată să facă sacrificiile care sunt necesare pentru ca să țină pe copiilor în această școală și să privești la sacrificiile pe care profesorii le fac, Doamne, la trebuințe care le au și să le răsplătești Tu osteneala și pe îngioșirea. Porți de grijă în acord cu bogăția Ta, așa cum ai promis, să le umpli casele de belșug și inimile de bucurie și să le oferi satisfacție, să vadă rezultate în lucrarea în care acum depun efort cu atâta dragoste. Fie îndurarea Ta peste noi și peste toată lucrarea aceasta la care ne-ai chemat. Și mulțumim că Tu faci mai mult decât cerem și ne dăjduim noi, pentru că Îți cerem în numele pentru meritele Domnului Iisus Mântuitorul nostru. Ne încredințăm în mâna Ta iubitoare. Dăm glorie numele Tău mare, care este vrednic de laudă, pentru că ești bun, pentru că ești credincios promisiunilor Tale și pentru că ne putem bizui pe resursele Tale pe care le-ai dat și ne-ai oferit în Duhul Tău cel Sfânt. Și Te lăudăm și Te glorificăm în veci. Amin.
Amin. Before you are seated, I want to ask all the teachers, whether you are Sunday school teachers or music teachers, to, for a second, just stand up and everybody else sits down, just so they see you and they can give you whatever encouragement or at least keep you in their prayers. So all the teachers, please. Trinity 2, my melody. I know you are one. Yes. Anybody that teaches people, okay? Thank you. May God bless you. Look around and just keep them in your prayers. Amen? Thank you. And turn our Bibles to the first epistle of the Apostle Paul to Corinthians, chapter 3. Starting with verse 5. My message tonight, just so maybe I can pique your interest, is where in the world do we find a Christian teacher? What then is Apollos? What is Paul? Servants through whom you believed, as the Lord assigned to each. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. He who plants and he who waters are one, and each will receive His wages according to His labor, for we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field, God's building. According to the grace of God given me, like a skilled master builder, I laid the foundation, and someone else is building upon it. Let each one take care how he builds upon it. For no one can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now if anyone builds on that foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become manifest, for the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. If the work that anyone has built on the foundation survives, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned up, he will suffer loss, though he himself will be saved, but only as through fire. Amen. You may be seated. So clearly, since it's a special service tonight for the Christian teachers, I'm going to try to focus on how this text applies to us, the Christian teachers. And as I said, the question is, very strange question, where in the world do we find a Christian teacher? But in order to arrive to the answer to that question, let's look at a few things that are revealed, I think, in this text. First of all, and not just in this text, connections with our entire Bible and also our knowledge and experience of the world. I would start with this first question: what is a teacher? What is a teacher? Well, first of all, a teacher is someone very important in any society. A teacher's role, and this is according to the most common thing, Wikipedia, teacher's role may vary among cultures. Teachers may provide instruction in literacy and numeracy, craftsmanship or vocational training, arts, religion, civics, community roles, life skills, etc., etc. A teacher forms society. Now, some people don't understand the importance of a teacher, but those who do will eventually take a hold of society and do with it what they want. Promoting the right kind of teacher, or the wrong kind of teacher, eventually will change the whole society. And we have to understand that all people, especially nowadays, and especially in the advanced communities, in the Western communities, but almost everywhere in the world, will go through school and will have to spend anywhere from 6 to 8 hours per day, more than they spend with any other human being, more than they spend with their parents. They don't spend 8 hours with their parents in close contact, absorbing what they say and absorbing what they do, as they do in school. And so a teacher is very, very important. He is the one who molds the next generation. And if we fail to understand that, we are going to see a great failure of what the next generation will be. So a teacher is a very important person in any society. And unfortunately, many times, Satan understands better than we do the importance of a teacher. And we can see that from many, many aspects. If you want, just look at the respect and authority that teachers, usually in secular societies, have many a time, as compared to Christian teachers. And you will see how societies that do not hold necessarily the Christian faith have more respect and understanding of the importance of a teacher than we do. And so then, the second question would be, what is a Christian teacher? I spoke about the teacher in general, but what is a Christian teacher? And I'm going to read something that I found in the documents of a school, a Christian school, and it's just the most general description of the teacher's attributes or tasks. That document was a very long one, and I said I'm not going to have time to read it to you. It was very, very illuminating and interesting to see when someone sits down and really spends time describing what they expect from a Christian teacher. I think it's a lot more that is expected from a Christian teacher than from just a regular teacher. But in a nutshell, that document was saying this from another sister Christian school: the teacher will prayerfully help students learn attitudes, skills, and subject matter that will contribute to their development as mature, able, and responsible Christian men and women to the praise and glory of God. Now, when you, that's like an onion. When you unfold that, you find so many layers, so many layers, so many, and the document was really very massive. I was really impressed. I said, I'm going to steal this one and apply it to our school, because it did the work that we did in a maybe a lesser measure in unfolding that. It goes kind of without saying in our school in many aspects, but it is good to see it written, to see the volume of expectation that we have from a Christian teacher. Christian teacher has a very important role, and it is to our advantage as churches, to understand that, to get engaged, to get connected with this movement of Christian education. And I'm very happy that Trinity is here through representatives, because we're so thankful that we can continue. We're finishing them off here, obviously, just joking, but we're finishing them off here, so to speak, and we're sending them to the other schools. And we'd like to know that there are other schools that take over the work and continue it. So the third point, going up on this ladder, is this. Okay, so we kind of see what a Christian teacher is and how many expectations we have from a Christian teacher. But what is a Christian teacher in Paul's estimation from this text? Do we see an expectation from the Apostle Paul, and clearly from God? Because who's Paul? A servant that wrote what was given to him by the Holy Spirit. And I think we do. Here's what Paul says, and I transcribe it to teachers because it's applicable, right? What does a teacher, Christian teacher, do? He builds a human being from K-2 to 12th grade, and then from K-12th grade to college and after, right? If he continues in a Christian school. But here's what Paul says. Teacher is a servant through whom children may believe as the Lord assigns to each. One plants, another waters, but God gives the growth. We are God's fellow workers. The children, your children, are God's field, God's building. Amen to that. And so we see here that the stakes are, I think, even higher than the previous statement set them at. Because here we see that not only there is an expectation that he will prayerfully consider and help students and so on and so forth, here the stakes are set where we are fellow workers with God. Now, it's one thing to fail a human boss, but if you're fellow workers with God and you fail him, I think it's much tougher. And so I think that the responsibility we have as teachers ought to, in first instance, crush us, only to be lifted by the grace of God. Ought to make us realize we are insufficient. Ought to give us that awesomeness and the humility of a God, all-powerful, who could have done everything just by saying it, and who yet chose to take upon himself this human flesh-type body and humble himself all the way down to our spit and despise and revilement and stupidity and stubbornness and just narrowness and cruelty and all the things in which we chose to throw ourselves in when we said, I want to taste that apple, even though he said it's not allowed. This God of ours chose to make himself a fellow worker with us. That ought to make us tremble. But at the same time, I think it makes us seek him more. Because if he is a fellow worker with us, it doesn't matter that I am a fellow worker with him. He is a fellow worker with me. I mean, imagine this. I'm going on a soccer field and I'm facing the Brazilian team. But with me is the best player in the world who can beat a team just by himself. Praise God. Or I'd be to Should I be scared by the Brazilian team? I hope nobody is offended here being Brazilian. I give them as an example of good soccer craftsmanship and skill. And so I'm saying that opposing God, they'll be defeated in no time, right? But this is what I'm saying. Even if I don't know soccer, if I go on the field with him, I should realize that the odds are in my favor. Praise God for that. So here's what I think that Paul says. In Paul's estimation, we have an awesomely scary and fearful job to do, which at the first sight seems impossible. But then if you think about it, since he is a fellow, he made himself a fellow worker with us, is more than doable. He never gives us things that we cannot do. He guarantees that because he's with us, that because he is in us, that because he already paid for what we broke, everything is fixable now by faith in him who shed his blood on the cross for this very reason. So my last point, because the first three, I kind of wanted to go fast through them to get to the last point. And this is a practical point. If that is the case, if that is the apostle's estimation of a Christian teacher, and the Bible's estimation, and God's estimation of a Christian teacher, what is then the Christian teacher's role in the plan and flow of the building, of the raising of this building, of the taking advantage of this field, that is namely the young children, your children, my children, who are entrusted to us as Christian teachers. Well, let's start very, as much as possible, systematically. The first thing that the Apostle Paul says, and is very applicable to us, is this: another lays, or laid the foundation, or should have laid the foundation. I want you to know that is not the Christian teacher's duty to lay the foundation. A lot of times, this is one of the main mistakes that is made in Christian education. The Christian teacher is not God, nor is he the church, nor is he the parent. He's only a delegate of these entities. And so before him, there is a duty that befalls us, the parents, the church, the Christian workers. It is prior to taking a kid to Christian school. He has to have a solid foundation set by his parents and by the church. Because on that, yes, we can build awesome things with God's help and glory and grace. But without that foundation, it is so difficult, it's almost impossible. And the Apostle Paul says, we, the apostles, sent by God, by God's glory, laid that foundation for you. It was a very small number of apostles, and they had the hardest task, and most of them paid with their lives this privilege. Just like Mr. Romanole, right, in a way, so to speak, but so much farther than that. But just I want you to understand, it was a huge sacrifice, and they gladly shed their lives and blood for this one reason: to give a foundation for people, faithful people that came after them, to be able to build upon. And we teachers gladly build upon a foundation, but it has to be set by the parents and the church. If that is done properly, we have a great success. If that isn't done properly, then the Christian teacher can still try to do something to compensate, but be very hard, and the hopes of success are very small. I have a text in Isaiah 28:9-13. That gives us a little bit of insight into something like this, in which the prophet decries the fact that when you try to build on a faulty foundation, even the best efforts, God's efforts, are doomed. Whom will he teach knowledge? And whom will he make to understand the message? Those just weaned from milk? Those just drawn from the breasts? For precept must be upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, line upon line, here a little, there a little. For with stammering lips and another tongue he will speak to these people, to whom he said, this is the rest with which you may cause the weary to rest, and this is the refreshing. Yet they would not hear, but the word of the Lord was to them precept upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, line upon line, here a little, there a little, that they might go and fall backward and be broken and snared and caught. And here, I think the prophet says exactly this. If there is no foundation, the effort is this. Then this is what the teachers do, precept upon precept, layer upon layer. Consistency, keeping them in focus, training them, but on a good foundation. If the foundation lacks, you see, the prophet says, who do you teach? Those that are just weaned, they don't have that foundation. It's going to fail. You need to have a foundation. So I encourage you, parents, Christian workers, Sunday school teachers, you realize you have an even more important job in a way than we do, because you have to put that foundation. They have to come to school, and when you don't have time to explain the Bible to them, you can make references to the Bible, but they need to know it. They need to read at home. They need to have fellowship with God at home. They ought to be asked at home, do you spend time with God? Do you wake up in the morning early enough to read your Bible and to pray and come to school thus prepared and, you know, in fellowship with God, so that when the Christian teacher who does the same thing at home connects you with God, you resonate and are not dull like something that has no tuning. Try to sing this orchestra with no tuning. You'll see what happens. We have to be in tune with God. The kids have to be in tune with God to respond to music, to be able to play the notes. And so this is one very important aspect of the Christian education. We love doing it. Praise God for that. It's a burden. It's a gift. If we don't discharge it, we feel like exploding. But it's so crushing, so hard. When you try to build and you see it crumbles. When you speak and there is no echo. When you play the instrument, it is completely out of tune. On that foundation, the Christian teacher builds upon layer, precept upon precept, together with the other fellow workers, the family, and the church. And I'm not going to, I have verses if you want to write them down. I want to save time, but we have verses in Romans 15:20 and 1 Corinthians 8, 10, 8 and 8 with verse 1, 10 with verse 23. We are told about God, about this process where we have to form the fellow believers, starting with the kids and the family and the church to the beginning, and the Christian teachers ought to do the finishing. I noticed something very interesting in this business, so to speak, in this Christian endeavor of molding people. The more time passes, the more the Christian teachers, the teachers in general, I ought to say, and this is what's very troubling, please note down, not just the Christian teachers, all teachers. But even more so the Christian teachers, but all teachers have more impact on their pupils than parents in church. Because more and more they know you as parents in church, they were exposed to you, they're kind of saturated by you, and now they want to hear other voices and see, do they concur to what was said before? Do the lives they see and observe match the words that were spoken? And they test those words. And if they find they're lying, they might go astray. And they need the teachers to confirm that. Now, if the teacher is Christian, that's great. Because he will say exactly what you would like him to say if he's a good believer. And most of them are, praise God. But if they're not, I don't know. Stomping on the flag to prove the First Amendment? I think, my humble opinion, you have other ways in which you can show that. You can show that you have the First Amendment speaking against abortions. Speaking against the oppressed, against the oppressing of the defenseless, right? Speaking against the horrors of ISIS and how they kill Christians by the thousands in the Middle East. You can show your rights of freedom of speech in many constructive ways. Why should you show it in a destructive way? When did ever showing a destructive way build something? So easy to destroy. Why not show something constructive? It's always a wonder to me how people choose to show their freedom by destroying stuff. That's not freedom. That's actually abuse. Because someone spent something to do that, then you're destroying it. It's not you that made it. But I found this, that the more time passes, the more the teachers have more impact on their pupils. And parents and church have a lesser voice, at least until a certain time when the kids, now young adults, become convinced that this thing is true. And people believe it because they live it and they stake their life on it. Now, since we build a human being, it must be in the image of Christ. It is a process of emulation. Will they have these children of ours? What and who to emulate? From you, the Christian teachers? From you, the parents? From you, the Christian workers? Are we in the business just for the money and for the convenience and for whatever? Or are we seriously in this business because we love Christ so much that we see His hand at work in our lives and He models us and we want to show these kids the same thing? We are ahead of them on the path. We ought to be very, at least compared with them, we ought to be very convinced that God does exist, does work, does help you. And you can show them because they're so confused compared to you. I hope. We have to be good models for them. Especially Christian teachers, do you realize you must know our Lord Jesus Christ well? From personal experience, from reading the scriptures on your own, daily, from prayer, daily on your own, from devotions and meditation, from walking with Him and obeying Him in hardship, doing His deeds. His deeds. What were Jesus' deeds? He helped the poor. He comforted the lonely. He touched the lepers, as we heard this morning. We have to have the same deeds to even have a glimmer of hope that we can impact these pupils of ours, these students, these children of ours. They will read that. You don't have to tell them that. They will read that. If you do that, they will read that. They will see it. They will see it in your eyes. They will see it in your confidence of walking with God. They will see it in the way you react when they present you with their insolvable problems. You know how adolescents find the most insolvable problems ever? And they come and they throw them at you with that, let me see how we do that. And you take it to Jesus, and he saw it, praise God. And then they see, they're amazed, and they say, yeah, this thing really does work. But you have to know him, right? You have to know him. So that this is an immediate reaction. It's not an afterthought. It's an immediate, your nature reaction to a challenge that is presented to you by some young, confused, but growing Christian. Praise God for that. Young, confused, in danger, but Christian. Praise God. God sent his son to die for our kids so they can be born again, and then we have to help them grow the image of Christ. And so, I encourage you, my fellow teachers, with humility, because I failed so many times at this too, to understand that more important than preparing your lesson, it is important to prepare your lesson, isn't it? I mean, how do you feel when you go in front of the class and you did not prepare your lesson? You wing it, right? Hopefully they're not going to ask you that one question that you don't know how to answer. And then you stammer for 15 minutes trying to find some solution to that, right? It's very bad when that happens, but how is it when you go unprepared spiritually? So I want to encourage you into this, more important than preparing the lesson. God says, these are the important things, these are the less important things. Don't leave these unimportant things undone, but first, do the important things, right? And what are the important things for the Christian teachers? To know him, to walk with him. I encourage you to pray. I encourage you to read your Bibles. You have to read your Bibles. And we know that I'm just preaching to the choir in a way, but it's good. Even the choir needs preaching. I tell you that. There is a warning that comes from this. We are called to build a human in the image of Christ. What materials are you going to use if you don't have them? The Bible says there are two options. You can use one kind of materials if you have them, or you can use the other kind of materials if you don't have the ones that you ought to have. And there is a warning that goes with this. The warning is that we need to make sure that we build with the proper materials, because there will be a QC examination. You know what a QC is, right? Quality control. God will check the quality of that thing. It's not like we just paint it nice and he's going to take it. No, he's going to test it with fire. It has to hold. Two metaphors used here. The object of building, the students, the children, are resembled to a field. And as a field, in real life, it must be first prepared for planting. You know how much goes into taking a wild land and making it ready for planting? You must first understand the quality of the ground of that field to know what kind of seed you can plant. You must identify the boulders and stones, and they must be removed or broken and removed. You must remove the weeds, plucked, burned, whatever. The ground must be plowed, and then the seed must be put in, sown evenly, consistently. There must be seed to begin with. You must have the seed to begin with. Then after you plant the seed, it must be watered evenly and consistently. And as the plants bud by God's grace, because he gives the life and the growth, as we heard, you must protect them and continue to weed them so as to have them reach that phase of harvest when we can celebrate what God has done in their lives. And the second metaphor is that of a building. In verse 9c, as a building, the foundation must be set deep and strong by God, first of all, then by the parents, as I said, and by the church. The Christian teacher is a fellow builder, worker with you, with the parents, with the church, with God. The warning is to make sure that we build on this foundation which is laid carefully by God with fireproof materials, because there is going to be a fire. There's going to be a fire now, there's going to be a fire then. Now the fire is the world, then God himself will test it with fire. These are expensive materials, and we might be tempted to say, I don't have it, I'm poor, I don't have these. But the reality is that no one is too poor to build with gold, silver, and precious stones, and I'm going to prove to you that. We all possess things that are expensive. I want to quote, first of all, C.S. Lewis. He was saying, and this was my inspiration for this little thing here. He said in one of his Narnia books, no one is too poor to have a noble death. No one is too poor to have a noble death. And no one is too poor to have a noble life either. And this is what God says here to the Apostle Paul. We all have gold, silver, and precious stones. And I'll just prove it to you. Think about it. Do you have things that are dear to you? Let's say you don't have money. You're very poor in all respects. You don't have talents. You don't have anything. But do you have things that are dear to you? Well, everybody loves his comfort. Everybody loves his freedom. Everybody loves his life. Everybody loves his friends. Everybody loves... We love so many things. We're rich beyond measure. Just think of you being stripped of all of these. Just think of you being put in a concentration camp where you have 5 minutes of sleep, and then 10 hours of work, and then 5 minutes of sleep, and 10 hours of work. Yeah, it's just no ending, no food, no clothing, no comfort, no nothing. Are we rich or what? Well, the Bible says those things ought to be used in building the new people. Well, we have them. Yeah, we might have to sacrifice them. The comfort, the time, the friends, the money, we have them. We never can excuse ourselves that we were poor. We have them. We all have them. It's just a matter of how willing are you to use these rather than the refuse, rather than the surplus, to build God's children. These are the gold, silver, and precious stones spoken of here, things which we appreciate and which we become willing to give up because we love Christ and we understand what he sacrificed for us. He, being rich beyond measure, gave it up all to find us and to bring us to life. We can fall into that trap of building with things that have a lot of value in themselves or for the world, but not for us. The surplus, the refuse of our lives, someone else's efforts, right? Isn't it easy to do that? When you find someone that is stupid enough to do your work and you kind of encourage him to do it, and you're so happy that he did it for you, and you know that person, everybody knows that person. I notice that everybody takes advantage of that person, because it makes your life easy, but so does God. He knows too. And you're building with refuse. When the fire comes, it will be ashes. It will be shame. Let's be proud of being co-workers with God and doing things for him just like he does them for us. What did God sacrifice for us? Of all the things he had, he gave up the most valuable thing. There was nothing else more expensive, more valuable than God had that he gave for us. We may pat ourselves on the back that the job got done. Praise God, right? But God is not interested in that. In the job being done, is interested in what the job is done with, by each of us, and how the job is done by each of us, and why the job is at least attempted, if not done, by each one of us. That's what God is interested in. Being done or not is not as important. It is, but not as important. The same building, the same materials used in making it, so to speak, might be gold for someone who sacrificed, and hay and stubble for someone else who pushed others to sacrifice. We have those pushers, those encouragers, right? We are encouraged by others to sacrifice. Ain't it nice to be like that? You know, just some sacrifice and some encourage them, cheer them up. Unless you are down there on the field playing the game, fighting the fight, it doesn't matter. It's stubble. It's gonna burn. Don't pagans do the same also? That's what the Bible says. What unusual thing do we do as a result of being born again believers, redeemed by the blood of Christ? That's the currency that was paid for me. I ought to keep that present in front of my eyes always. For if you love those who love you, what reward have you? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet your brethren only, what do you do more than others? Do not even the tax collectors do so? IRS received the numbers, right? We're not saying no IRS, but you understand, these were the people that really hated in Israel. Therefore, you shall be perfect just as the Father in heaven is perfect. I want to come to a close here. And I want to give you again the words of the Apostle Paul, who we know from history matched his life, praise God, matched his life. My prayer is that I also have words given by God that are also matched by my life. And my prayer for everybody here is the same, that we have an equality between the words we say, the praise of God, and our lives. Here is what the Apostle Paul says in 2 Corinthians 12:15. And I will spend very gladly and be spent for your souls, though the more abundantly I love you, the less I am loved. But that doesn't matter. I will gladly spend myself, or my substance and myself. And Paul did that. And this is what a Christian teacher that is a good believer does. Without writing, without looking at the others, they don't do that. The other people don't do that. These other teachers don't do that. Who cares? You follow me. That's what Jesus says. Don't look at the other ones. They're not the shepherd. Follow me. Follow me. Do your thing. As you see me do my thing, says God. And as we approach this solemn moment, when we want to benedict the teachers, the parents, and the students for the school year, let's remember what a teacher is. Let's remember what a Christian teacher is. Let's remember what a Christian teacher is in the Bible, in the Bible's estimation, and what specifically the role of a Christian teacher is in the plan and flow of the building of the little people into full Christians, in the likeness of Christ, asking the Father of all mercies, God Almighty, to grant his blessings, protection, authority, and help in this holy and vital endeavor. So where in the world do you find a Christian teacher? In a good Christian school where faith is kept high. I pray that our school is such a school. And I pray that all Christian schools are such schools. May God bless us all.
Stand up.
I'm going to call Stella here at the pulpit to close with a prayer.
I should never end up here, I'm somewhere down there, but
Let's pray. Lord, thank you for the privilege that we have for us to be tonight in your house, and for us to have the privilege to praise your name. Please continue to bless our schools, continue to bless our faculty, continue to bless our parents, students, and continue to bless the ones that are helping us out in one way or another, whether playing, or with funding, or with volunteering. Continue to give them the grace to do it even this year. Help us give you the glory in everything that we do, and help us even this year walk in your ways, so our lives will show you and be an example for the people outside. In Christ's name, pray. Amen.
Amen. Now to Him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of His glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, and now, and forever. Amen. May God bless you, walk with God, and be a blessing. Amen. Amen.